today he'll be sharing with us his key insights from his forthcoming book, The Blockchain Transformation. Please join me in welcoming Jack Shaw.
Thank you, Vince. This is the Queen Elizabeth. For 50 years in the first part of the 20th century, she and her sister ocean liners dominated the market for transatlantic business transportation. If you wanted to travel from New York to London, you traveled by ship. Now, by the late 30s, it had become possible to fly commercially across the ocean. But as any of the owners of the ocean ship carriers would have told you, what self-respecting business person would ever want to spend 18 to 30 hours of cramped, cold, noisy discomfort when traveling by ship? They could ride in comfort, indeed, and luxury, and arrive at their destination in less than a week. No, they would have told you, business people will never forego the convenience and comfort of crossing the ocean by ship. And so it was, until August of 1957, when Pan American Airlines introduced Boeing 707 nonstop jet service from New York to London in 8 hours. And in 6 months' time, the transatlantic passenger ship industry lost 90% of its customers. Disruptive technological innovation can have a powerful and rapid impact on industries. We are at the cusp of just such a disruptive technological innovation today. As a professional technology futurist for the past 30 years, I've learned to heed the words of that great American philosopher, Yogi Berra, who said, "Making predictions is very hard, especially about the future." And I've learned over the years that my predictions are not always well accepted. For example, I was speaking to a manufacturing group about 20 years ago about this new technology called the World Wide Web. I did a demonstration where I logged onto Amazon.com, ordered a copy of my own book, had it shipped to the president of the trade association, and said, "So, what do you think?" And one of the executives in the room raised his hand. He said, "Jack, that's fascinating, very, very interesting, but help me understand, what has this got to do with us? We're manufacturers. We don't sell books." A few months later, I was speaking at a technology conference, and I was talking about this emerging business practice called electronic commerce and describing some scenarios of the near future. After the presentation, a fellow came up and collared me. He said, "Jack," he said, "I love your optimism and your enthusiasm about the future," he said, "but clearly there's a lot you don't understand about technology." And I said, "Well, please, by all means, enlighten me." And he said, "Well, we don't even really have the processing power. We may never have the bandwidth, and we'll certainly never have the security. So this notion you're peddling that someday people are going to be sitting at their computers and doing their banking electronically online will never happen. It just can't be done." Well, whether people do not want to accept predictions because they don't think they apply to their business or because they simply don't believe they're technologically possible, that's fine. Nevertheless, I'm still going to go out on a limb and make a few predictions today. So please, join me on a short trip to the near future. In our first scene, a preteen needs orthodontic work. But she and her parents don't just go see the nearest orthodontist or one a friend or relative happens to recommend. Instead, they post an online request for proposals that can only be seen by nearby registered orthodontists, and they receive several such proposals, each of which states the orthodontist's qualifications and a suggested treatment plan with estimated costs. So they speak to a couple of the orthodontists by phone, and she and her parents select one to meet with in person. Once they've reviewed the treatment plan and payment schedule with the orthodontist, they authorize it via digital signatures through their smartphones. The family's health care insurance makes progress payments immediately on completion of each visit, and the family makes their co-payments using airline frequent flyer miles, and no paperwork is ever required. In our second scene, an aircraft is halfway across the ocean when it detects that a critical part must be replaced on arrival. The airline's advanced procurement system scans the internet to identify FAA-certified providers of the required part. The system then negotiates pricing, terms, and conditions, selects a provider, and incorporates those terms and pricing into a legally enforceable online smart contract. The part's design is then downloaded to a 3D printer at the airport, and the part is waiting when the aircraft arrives. In our third scene, a young couple is buying a new home. They first solicit offers from qualified mortgage providers by authorizing them to securely review their online credit histories. Each mortgage provider responds with approval for a mortgage within a specified purchase price range. The couple then visits houses via virtual reality and selects one they'll go to see in person. On their way, they request a title search, and they ask each mortgage provider to propose a mortgage plan for this specific property. On arrival, they're delighted that the house is just as nice as they had thought. They agree on a purchase price with the seller and select a mortgage plan. Since the title search has been completed by this time, they close the deal on the spot, again, via digital signatures on their smartphones. No paperwork, no brokers, no attorneys, and in fact, no keys are even exchanged, as the house and all its systems are now controlled via their own biometrics, fingerprints, voice prints, and retinal scans. What will make these extraordinary examples of innovation possible? Well, clearly, a number of technologies come into play. 3D printing, virtual reality, biometrics, and more. But there's one that runs through all of these examples. Many have already recognized it as the most important technology to emerge since the internet itself. This technology doesn't simply enable improvements in specific areas. It facilitates the digital transformation of entire business and social ecosystems. Healthcare, transportation, manufacturing, financial services, and real estate are just a few of the many potential applications of this technology across every industry, including yours. While this technology has been around for nearly a decade, most people have just heard about it in the last year or so. It's called blockchain. And no less reputable a publication than The Economist magazine has said that this technology is the most important advance in record keeping since the invention of double entry bookkeeping in Florence, Italy, in 1494, over 500 years ago. When I keynoted the Global Blockchain Conference in London earlier this year, I pointed out that blockchain technology, wherever people, processes, businesses, governments, or the social good requires proof of identity, of ownership, of transactions, or of contractual commitments, Blockchain technologies promise to meet those needs with a degree of trust and integrity never before possible. How do blockchain technologies do that? Well, they do four important things. First, they create a permanent, immutable, signed and time-stamped record of identity, ownership, transactions, or contractual commitments. Second, they allow two or more entities, people, businesses, or other organizations, to share this information on the internet without having to rely on any one of the others or to pay a third-party service to be the master record keeper. This has huge implications for most industries because it eliminates the need for businesses that do nothing more than act as informational intermediaries. Third, they make this information globally available with complete transparency so that all those so authorized can easily view or update that information whenever they need to, while at the same time, fourth, providing unhackable security against those who are not authorized to change or even see that information. Now, the first use case for blockchain was the digital currency Bitcoin. And in fact, blockchain was developed originally to enable this first functional digital currency. For over 8 years now, the Bitcoin blockchain has been working and billions of dollars worth of transactions have taken place. Yet despite the concerted efforts of the world's most cunning digital criminals, the Bitcoin blockchain has never been hacked. How is that possible, you may ask? Well, let's take a look at how Bitcoin works on its blockchain. Blockchains maintain multiple identical copies of the blockchain data distributed across numerous locations or nodes all over the internet. Various different blockchain implementations use anywhere from dozens to hundreds to thousands of nodes. And every time a record is added to the blockchain, those additions are replicated at every node within minutes, in many cases within seconds. Advanced cryptography and synchronization technologies ensure that every node is identical to all of the rest. So, if you want to actually make a payment of Bitcoin, let's say, from party A to party B, that transaction is represented online as a block. And that block is broadcast to every other party in the network. Those parties then each go through that cryptographic synchronization technology to ensure that that block is valid, and then add that block to the chain, and now you have indelible records all over the internet showing that that bit of money no longer belongs to party A, but now belongs to party B. Now, when these blocks are added to the blockchain, they are linked to each other using what is called a hashing algorithm. To explain how a hashing algorithm works, let me ask you a question. How many people here have taken an apple or another piece of fruit or vegetable, put it in a juicer, and gotten a container of juice out as a result, or watched somebody else do it? Let me see. Okay, just about everyone has, of course. Now, how many of you have taken a container of juice, poured it into a juicer, run it backwards, and gotten an apple out? No? No takers on that one? It's not a reversible process. You can't reverse engineer it. You can't unscramble the proverbial egg. Well, there are mathematical algorithms that work exactly the same way. These hashing algorithms, you can input a data file, run it through the algorithm, and get a unique fixed-length string of characters as output. The same data file will always produce the exact same string of characters. But there's no way you can start with a string of characters and work backward to figure out what the content of the original file was. And it doesn't matter whether you input a single word, a sentence, or the entire contents of War and Peace. You'll still get a unique, fixed-length string of characters as output. But if you change anything, whether it's a single word in the sentence, or whether it is simply deleting a comma from all of War and Peace, you will get a different string of characters as output. And not just a slightly different string of characters, a completely radically different string of characters. Now, when blocks are added to the blockchain, and they're added everywhere from every few seconds to every few minutes, depending on the blockchain, the header of each new block contains a copy of the hash of the contents of the previous block. That chains that new block to the previous block, hence the term blockchain. So, suppose you wanted to, a hacker wanted to make an illicit change to a record on the blockchain, and they're somehow able to hack into one of the nodes. They could change that block, but then the contents of the header of the next block would no longer match the hash of its predecessor. So they would have to recalculate that next block and update the hash in that header. But now the hash value in the header of the subsequent block would no longer match the hash value of that next block. So you would have to recalculate the hash for the subsequent block, and you would have to continue to do that for each and every one of the thousands or tens or hundreds of thousands of blocks in that copy of the blockchain. And even if you did that, what you would end up with is simply a copy of the blockchain that no longer matches all of the others of copies of the blockchain in the world. And therefore, it would be declared invalid and ignored, and the correct valid information would still reside on all of those other copies of the blockchain. So, if you really wanted to hack, and here's an example. This is a map of the over 7,000 nodes of the Bitcoin blockchain. Not surprisingly, you can see that they're tend to cluster in areas of greatest economic activity. But if you really wanted to hack an entire blockchain, you'd have to hack into a majority of those nodes, completely recompute the hashes for and rewrite the contents of every single block on that copy of the blockchain. But you'd have to do it for a majority of those nodes. You'd have to do it simultaneously, and you'd have to get it done within 10 minutes. Because as soon as the blockchain resynchronizes, all your illicit efforts at changing it are down the tubes. One physicist has estimated that the amount of energy that would be required to drive the amount of computing power that would be needed to simultaneously hack all of these nodes all over the world, rewrite all of their contents, and get that all done before the blockchain resynchronizes is approximately equal to the amount of energy emitted during the same period of time by the sun. So, the purists may say, well, it's always theoretically possible to hack a block, anything. True, but it's economically impossible. What we have with blockchain technology is simply a level of security many orders of magnitude greater than anything we have ever had before, and that's why it's never been hacked. So people have come to realize that if we can use the blockchain for digital currency, why can't we use it for other digital assets like electronic medical records? Like a 3D printing design file, or a real estate property deed. In fact, I was recently very excited to see this recent headline that Georgia expands project to secure land titles on the blockchain. Wow, who knew they were even working on that? Until I looked closer and realized it was the other Georgia, the nation of Georgia, not the state of Georgia, yet. One of the things that can be stored on a blockchain is a smart contract. Now, this is much more than just a permanent record of a traditional contract created in a word processor. It's a dynamic contract that can enforce its own provisions. A smart contract is a computer program running on a blockchain that can take custody over assets on that blockchain, can track information that has happened to date, and can take action based on that incoming information. Such as, for instance, identifying that an orthodontic appointment has been completed and automatically transferring funds immediately into the account of the orthodontist in payment for that completed appointment. Blockchain technology is already producing astonishing results. Last fall, I keynoted the Global Big Data Conference in Qingdao, a major port on the northeast coast of China. By an extraordinary coincidence, a ship arrived in Qingdao just the previous weekend with a load of cotton being sold from a company in Houston, Texas, to a company in China. Now, typically in international trade today, processing the paperwork necessary to transfer ownership, to pay the seller and the freight carrier, takes about 10 days. In this case, though, because all of the information was shared on the blockchain, ownership was transferred, and the seller and freight carrier were paid in full in 10 minutes. And I was able to talk about it to my audience in Qingdao just 3 days later. A key component of blockchain technologies is the concept of self-sovereign digital identity. Information about a person, including their biometric identifiers, can be stored along with such documents as their passport, driver's license, social security information, and so forth. And what this will provide is the ability for people to have protection against identity theft, far greater than what we have today, to confirm their professional credentials. For example, that this person is an authorized registered orthodontist practicing within a given geographical location, allow them to receive efficient execution of government services that they are authorized to receive, and allow businesses to know for certain exactly who their customers and their suppliers are. And identity isn't just for people. It's also for things, such as the 10 billion or so things already on the Internet of Things, likely to exceed a trillion within the next decade or so. But how do you know that the information that appears to be coming from a specific thing is actually coming from that thing and hasn't been spoofed or changed? Combining blockchain with Internet of Things technology can solve these problems, and will. One of my clients, Bosch, has worked with the German company TÜV to tie the Internet of Things to blockchain to permanently record auto odometer readings. So a connector in the car periodically, like every few minutes, sends an update of the mileage reading to a blockchain-based record that the owner can check at any point in time if they don't happen to recall what their mileage is for whatever reason they may need to know it. But also when it comes time to sell the car, the accuracy of the odometer reading can be proved because the blockchain contains an immutable record of what those all were. And even if somebody goes in digitally to set back the odometer on the car, there's a record of what was already set in there previously. There are even efforts underway to use the blockchain to provide fraud-free voting.
The time has come to bring voting into the 21st century. Let's be honest. No one likes searching for their polling place, waiting in long lines when they arrive. And when the ballots are cast, can we even be sure they get counted correctly? We can do better. And at Follow My Vote, we've figured out just how to do it. We threw out all preconceived notions about the way voting is done today and imagined how it should be done tomorrow. It was immediately clear that an honest election needs to be verified from end to end, so there was no choice but to bring it online. Leveraging blockchain technology in combination with elliptic curve cryptography, we've broken open the ballot box to allow everyone to count the votes, all without compromising privacy or security. Instead of waiting in line, imagine voting from the comfort of your own home on your own device, and even following your vote into the ballot box to confirm that it was cast as intended and counted as cast. Online voting. You want it? You got it. Finally, online voting. Follow my vote. Pass it on.
Of course, this would also have the beneficial side effect of freeing us up from having to listen to spurious political claims of voter fraud. Any politician who really believes voter fraud is taking place should be behind this 200%. In healthcare, blockchain promises to finally solve the challenge of readily interchangeable electronic medical records with patient-mediated health data exchange. Through patient consent management, this will provide accountability, transparency, privacy, security, control, and provenance of patient health care records that belong not to the providers, not to the insurance company, but to each of us as patients. And these are just a few of the many industries impacted by blockchain. There are dozens more. Here we see a list of just some of those industries that already have active blockchain initiatives underway. Many of these industries have already formed formal industry blockchain consortia, a few of which are listed here. And those consortia, in turn, have identified hundreds of use cases for blockchain, a small selection of which is shown here. And you may ask, what about meta businesses? In fact, some of you may ask, what is a meta business? Well, a meta business is a business whose business is to help other businesses better manage their business. Got it? All right, so examples of meta businesses include such things as accountants, auditors, attorneys, advertising, financiers, and so forth. When it comes to accounting and auditing, with blockchain, all of the partners in a given business ecosystem can have shared ledgers of the details of every transaction that gives rise to accounting entries. These shared ledgers can then be a single source of truth for all the players in that ecosystem. They can also provide read-only access to authorized external entities, such as regulators and auditors, who can then instantly and automatically verify and validate those transactions for reporting or other regulatory purposes. So, I'm afraid that the green eye-shaded accountant who painstakingly cross-foots debits and credits is going to go the way of the horseless carriage. There will still be jobs for human auditors, no matter how much new technology comes along. But those auditors who understand, monitor, and improve analytical and cognitive processes using blockchain-based information are the ones that will really thrive in the market of the future. Now, the same thing holds true for attorneys. Equally transformational effects on law firms and the legal profession will impact them in four key ways. First, the legal issues around implementation of blockchain. Companies will be looking to their attorneys to help them deal with issues like know your customer and anti-money laundering in banking financial services, HIPAA in healthcare. The new business models that result from blockchain-enabled disintermediation of key functions and in some cases whole organizations. Title search in real estate, customs brokerage and supply chain management. New business models will emerge. Attorneys will have to help people negotiate those new environments. They'll also have to help them understand how contracts are drafted and executed, because in many cases, especially for transactional contracts, that will all be done online. And what that means is, in part, that attorneys are going to need to learn to think like and work with software coders. Even though they won't necessarily actually have to write the code themselves, although I know a few that do, and believe me, they are in tremendous demand. When it comes to finance, you might ask why stocks, bonds, and other financial instruments can't also be issued via the blockchain. And in fact, they can. Last year, the state of Delaware passed legislation facilitating issuance of blockchain-based shares by Delaware corporations. This increases the speed of trading and settlement, reducing the traditional T+3-4 securities settlement to T+0, near real-time settlement, reduces trading costs, and allows for shares that are traded on the blockchain to benefit from more efficient and transparent proxy voting and dissemination of information to the shareholders. You can also invest in blockchain solutions if you choose to. Already such venture capital firms as the Digital Currency Group, Blockchain Capital, Pantera, and others have developed specialized portfolios focused on investing in blockchain companies. But something even more extraordinary is happening. The dawn of ICOs, initial coin offerings, using the power of blockchain technology itself to raise money to fund blockchain-enabled technology solutions. Using this capability, local Atlanta company Patientory raised $7.2 million in 3 days. Pillar raised $15 million in 3 hours. Bancor raised $153 million in 3 hours. And Brave raised $35 million in 24 seconds. In fact, by the end of the first half of 2017, the total investments in blockchain companies via ICOs had already exceeded that coming from traditional venture capital firms. At this point, already more than $2 billion has been raised via initial coin offerings, most of that in the past 90 days. I'm already working with several companies here in Atlanta and around the world who are planning their own initial coin offerings, ICOs. Blockchain is opening up a whole new world of possibilities for digital transformation. And blockchain plays a unique and critical role in digital transformation. Most emerging technologies are point solutions. 3D printing, augmented reality, Internet of Things, even artificial intelligence, they tend to apply within a specific organizational process or even at a particular geographic location. Blockchain is different. Blockchain provides the decentralized infrastructural glue that can tie all of these points together, thereby enabling the digital transformation of not just individual processes or even organizations, but entire business and social ecosystems. Blockchain transformation is not about force-fitting new technologies, even ones as powerful as blockchain, into your existing business processes and infrastructure. It starts by rethinking the business or social system your organization is operating within. And then, because blockchain is a team sport, the greatest results come from when you can cooperate with others in your ecosystem to use blockchain as an enabler to reduce costs, to save time, to eliminate errors from your ecosystem's processes. Then it's about rethinking the role of your business within this digitally transformed business ecosystem, how you can add the most value, and what your business model needs to be to enable you to do that. Then, having reconceptualized the ecosystem, the business model, now apply any and all of the technologies needed to implement that new vision. Now, in working with our clients over the years, one of the things that we've found most effective in terms of developing your blockchain transformation strategy is what's called third horizon planning, working with three parallel components. First, developing that long-term vision of the blockchain-enabled digital ecosystem, and then of that blockchain-enabled digital business model for your organization that I mentioned, looking out 2 to 3 to 5 years into the future. Second, first horizon planning, doing your traditional annual planning with your existing core operations, but understanding that given a blockchain transformation of your ecosystem in the future, some of the things you are doing today simply will not need to be done at all anymore. How much money and effort do you want to invest in enhancing processes that will be going away? Not too much in most cases. Focus on those things that will still be there, even though they may be dramatically digitally transformed as a result of blockchain in the near future. Then you fill in the gaps, the new things you're going to want to be able to do to take full advantage of a blockchain-enabled transformed ecosystem in the future. Developing expertise with blockchain and other technologies that you may not have operational expertise with yet. Developing experience with revised business processes and business models, with the idea that these second horizon skunk works kinds of activities, if you will evolve and mature over time and eventually merge in with the evolution of your existing first horizon capabilities to deliver on the long-term vision for the organization as a whole. Now, if your organization needs a much more in-depth understanding of blockchain, the American Blockchain Council has developed a series of blockchain executive seminars. The purpose of these seminars is to help C-level executives and other senior business decision makers, including people like accountants, auditors, attorneys, and IT, to understand the strategic business implications of blockchain technology. The topics covered in these seminars include such things as, what is blockchain and how does it work? What about identity and security? What's a smart contract? What are the legal and accounting issues? How do we tie blockchain to the Internet of Things, to artificial intelligence, 3D printing, augmented reality, or other emerging technologies? How will this impact our industry? What new opportunities are presented for our business? How do we go about developing our overall strategy for a blockchain-enabled business digital transformation? If you think we've seen a lot of changes in our world in the 10 years now since the first smartphones were introduced, you ain't seen nothing yet. We are going to see more change driven by a host of emerging technologies, most importantly blockchain. We're going to see more change in the next 10 years than we've seen in the past 50. This means you're going to have to change. You're going to have to change your mindset. You're going to have to change your organizational culture. You're going to have to change your business processes. You're going to have to change your business model. You're going to have to change your business ecosystems. That's a lot of change. But as the great historian Henry Steele Commager put it so well, change does not necessarily assure progress, but progress implacably requires change. Join us in using blockchain as a powerful new tool to help change your business, change your industry, and change the world. Thank you for listening. Thank you.